Yes, with this basics in mind, let us now dive into the subject. So if you see the Bayer Act is divided into various chapters. Companies Act has how many chapters? 29 chapters. And we are around 470 sections. So now we have to do one section. We'll do little slow, we'll go because it is interesting. And we should understand how it works. So in the Bayer Act, many sections are there, but I would just concentrate on one section for now, section 179. So those of you who have downloaded the app, they can go through that, no problem. You can read it together. One disclaimer I'll give you. First, this half day, you will have no clue what the hell is going on. I'm telling you now only. You'll be like, what the hell is going on? It's like a Christopher Nolan movie. You have no clue, right? But in the end, it will all come in place. If these basics are not done, it is impossible for us to move ahead. This is the basic overall structure. If I ask you some questions, answer those questions, let's see, then I'll see if your basic is strong. What is ordinary resolution? So many places we hear, no? Ordinary resolution. What is ordinary resolution? Is it more than 50%? More than or equal to 51% or greater than or equal to 50%? That is question number one. I got four different answers now. What is special resolution? More than 75, greater than or equal to 75. See, that's the thing. And in MCQ, this only they'll give. Right? And this is IPC syllabus for your information, whatever I'm asking. Correct? What do you mean by ordinary business? Dividend distribution is ordinary business. Auditor's appointment. If dividend is distributed, theoretically, if dividend is distributed in an extraordinary general meeting, is it ordinary business? If auditors are appointed in EGM, possible. Old auditor died, old auditor resigned. Immediately I called an extraordinary general meeting and appointed him. Appointment of auditor, is it ordinary business? See again, your appointment of auditor is ordinary business? No. See, confusion, right? Slight confusion. You are not telling it short. You are not telling it 100%. Now this is the answer. What is special notice? Should special notice be sent for special business? Or should special notice precede every special resolution? These are IPCC syllabus questions. But we don't know. It's fine, no problem. Okay, government company means what? More than 50%. More than 51%. Greater than or equal to 51%. What, which one? More than 51. Gone. Wrong. More than 50, gone. Okay, held by whom? Government. Of what? Issued share capital, paid up share capital, subscribed share capital. What is holding company? What is subsidiary company? Holding company holds how much? More than 50, more than 51, greater than or equal to 51? More than 50, 51. Of what? Issued capital, paid up capital, subscribed capital. Wrong. Think about it. Everything is wrong. What I am saying is, that is the, I knew, foundation is always weak. It is not your mistake at all. Whoever has taught you in IPCC, that fellow's mistake. If it's me, I'm sorry. Right? But no, I would have, that's why I introduced this Bayer Act in CPT only. All my students study Bayer Act from CPT level. That's what it should have been introduced. They should do it actually from CPT. Nevertheless, without reading. Now, all the answers are not given in any textbook. It's given in the source document right in front of you. That is the Bayer Act. So, I asked you these questions and the answers we will have to do it now. That's the reason why. Our basics, our foundation is weak, unfortunately. Without our foundation being strong, it is not possible to do anything. If you are a insane hitter in cricket, Nothing matters if your technique is horrible. You can never be a good test player. And the true sport, the true beauty of the sport is test cricket. That's why it's called a test, because it's testing your ability. So all these wonderful players who go bam bam in T20, if they don't have a proper technique, they are doomed in test match. So that's why test cricket is still respected. Our technique should be amazing. So really, if you get 60, 50, 70, 80, I mean 65, doesn't matter, as long as your technique is sound. So we need to ensure that our technique is sound. That's the idea. So I asked you so many questions, most of it is wrong. Tell me, is foreign company a company? Is foreign company a company? No? Foreign company is not a company. Body corporate. It is a company. Some of you are telling company, some of you are in body corporate. So it's foreign company is not a company then? That's the thing. So that's what. So all these small things, no, it comes only in the barrack. So when I am doing it now, the next whatever few minutes, the thing is, you will have no clue what is happening, because I am going to mix and match so many sections. What I am only giving a disclaimer is, have patience. Do not get worried. So many interconnections, I am getting confused. You will 100% feel. Don't worry. You blindly trust me. That's what I am trying to tell. You already trusted me only and come here. I am just asking you again, because this portion, what I am starting, is a disclaimer. You will be thinking, what the hell is happening? So you need to be, keep calm. I will take you to so many sections, still you will feel miserable. Why is this fellow doing so many sections? I am getting confused. Will happen, 100%. It's okay. In the end, everything will come back. So just, let's be patient, guys. Come on, let's start. 179. I'll read here. It's put up on screen also for your benefit. No tension. But yeah, if you can read on your own, you can read. No tension. You can read yours, whatever your mobile, or you can see the screen, your wish, whatever you are comfortable. No tension. Powers of the board. Now, why randomly I'm picking this section, I'll tell you. Because first two lines change things. If I ask you a question, who is more powerful, board or shareholders? What will you tell? I can get two different answers now if I divide. Some of you will say board, some of you will say shareholders. Who is more powerful? See, I got different answers. So the thing is, that is given in section 179. The board of directors of a company, it says a company, means what? Whenever act uses a company and nothing is given around it, it means what? All types of companies are covered. What are the types of companies? Private, public, one person company, small company. What is a small company? Company other than big company. Yes, what is small company? Turnover less than 2 crore. Is it less than or equal to or less than? Your MCQ will be like this only. Not exceeding, less than, gone. Right, that's the thing. And paid up capital? 50 lakhs. So is it not exceeding, or is it not less than, or is it less than, or is it not exceeding, that is less than or equal to, is what we need to understand. If I have turnover 20 lakhs, paid up capital 20 lakhs, turnover 3 crores, is it a small company? You just told me, before doing this, I'm asking some questions. You told me turnover should be less than 2 crore, you told me. Then you told me, paid up capital should be less than 50 lakh. I asked you whether it is less than or equal to or less than. You didn't have an answer because you would have read somewhere less than. We didn't read the source. That's okay. I am taking some random one. Paid up capital is just 10 lakhs. Turnover is 2.1 crore. Am I still a small company? What I am asking is, what is there in between, or and? That will 100% ignore always. Are you sure about it? If I show you in the barrack, if it's or? It was or, but we have to read as and. All those things are there, guys. That's why I'm saying. And these things only they ask in the exam. Correct? And they have used the term not exceeding. They have used the term not exceeding, which means what? Less than or equal to. Less than or equal to. So let's take a company where turnover is exactly 2 crore. Paid up capital is exactly 50 lakh. So answer, forget about and or, we have both have given within the limit. What is the answer? Small company, not small company. Small company, wrong answer. Because small company is only a private company. Correct? That is why I am saying. The only way to figure out all these things is the Bare Act. If you see small company definition, small company is a company other than a public company. That's the first condition. We'll never read that in the question paper. We'll never read X Limited. We'll only be fixated on this. This is called red herring. You would have heard red herring prospectus there. This is red herring. Means they are divert your attention to something else. But you need to see something else. That's why I told you, you will 100% get confused in the next 1 hour. Do not even care about it. I am giving you a disclaimer. In the end, it will all come in place. It's like a jigsaw puzzle. Initially, you will not understand anything. Later, it will come back. So now when I ask you, a company, obviously it means all types of companies. The board of directors of a company shall be entitled. Shall be is mandatory or discretionary? Mandatory. Entitled, right or duty? Entitled. You are entitled to your opinion. Right. Right? Entitled to exercise all such powers and to do all such acts and things as the company is authorized to exercise and do. Means what? They are trying to tell, yeah, company doesn't have brains. Company doesn't have brains. Company is an artificial person. Whatever the company could have done, who can do? Board. The first dialogue only, powerful dialogue in 179, they are saying whatever a company could have done, I am changing your methodology, so you need to be a little patient. It's fine. Till today, you have not studied law the way it has to be studied. I can 100% tell you that. From today, things change. And is it too late? Definitely not. Don't worry. So whatever company could have done, if company had brains of its own, in simple language, you are writing. Who will do it? Board can do. Board of directors can do. Now interconnection starts. Board of directors means, can it be a company? Or should it be individual? What I am saying is, okay, this you tell me. X Limited, Y Limited, Z Limited, can they start A Limited? They can't start. Three companies can't start one company. They can. They can 100% start. Right? So, can they be subscribers to memorandum companies? Yes. But I am saying now, on the board of A Limited, should there be individuals or can the company sit? Individuals. Why? Why? The logic. Why should individuals sit on the board? Why can't it be companies? Where like individuals will sit representing the companies, or rather basically companies sitting but represented by an individual, or should only be that particular individual only? Director's qualification? Individual they have given. Okay. So if you see, I'll take you to one more section, 149. That's what? This may create confusion. Going from one section, another section, don't worry. That's why I'm keeping on repeating. Do not worry. So every company, see, this is 149.1. Forget about section numbers and all that. I'm just showing you how it is in the Bare Act. Every company shall have a board of directors consisting of, directly they have given there. Individuals. That is the reason why if I come back here, I have gone to one more section. Ignore the section number, it's absolutely fine. In 149, I have seen it can only be individuals. So my general understanding from this first dialogue of 179 is that whatever the company could have done, if company had brains of its own, who can do? Board. And the board should always be a group of individuals. Now I asked you that first question, who is more powerful? Shareholders or board? Whoever told shareholders, your answers are wiped out till now. Why? Because I told whatever the company can do, who can do? Board. It seems that company is all powerful. I mean, board is all powerful. Because whatever the company could have done, board can do. Which means I can say board is like the brains behind the company. They are the brains. Which means we have to take some examples. First example we will take in this section only, 179 subsection 3. To understand, here only 149 done, 179 we are seeing anyway. Anyway, section numbers you leave, guys. I'm just trying to tell you. And again, I'm going to interconnect so many sections here. Do not worry, I repeat. So 179 3, there only in this section, the board of directors of a company shall exercise the following powers on behalf of the company by means of resolution passed at meeting of the board. Namely, so if you see all, you will be feel it very familiar. Make calls on shareholders, call money, buy back, issuing shares, any share you issue, equity, preference, debenture, bond, is a part of security. Borrowing money, investing fund, if they want to grant loan, if they want to approve finance, everything should be done by the board. At what meeting? Board meeting resolution. Which means, what I am trying to tell is, in 179.3, Companies Act is giving the power to the board of directors to do it. If the board of directors are doing it, Companies Act has given the power, the board of directors to do it. Tell me, guys, can the shareholders interfere? When explicitly I have given it, only the board should do, can the shareholders interfere? No. Shareholders cannot interfere. Because power is given only to the board. That's the beauty of law. Here exactly given whom? On basis of, if you say shareholders can interfere, what's the point of having Companies Act then? And Companies Act is telling only board should do. What's the point of shareholders interfering? No, right? So when explicitly Act gives the power to the share, to the board, only the board should do. These two dialogues will wipe out the people who told shareholders are powerful. But the thing is, you would have heard it that shareholders are powerful somewhere. That's why you even told, no? Correct. Which means you are also partly right somewhere. That's why I need to see in 179 this one. Provided further. Whenever Act uses the word provided, it is called as a proviso or a proviso. Whichever way you want to, you know, think about it, you can say proviso or a proviso. What does a proviso or a proviso do? It either adds on to the subsection or gives an exception to the subsection. This is my old syllabus, guys. Interpretation of statutes. New syllabus, guys, we'll have to know this. Otherwise, what is the point of learning law? Correct, no? Old syllabus, guys, bumper. They'll ask this for 3 marks. Explain what is a proviso with example. That's it. Right? So, proviso will, or proviso may or may not come in every subsection. So what will be the first proviso termed as provided that? Second proviso, provided further that. Third proviso, provided also. Fourth proviso, also. No, fourth proviso is also. That's it. From third onwards, it's only also. If there are 10 proviso also, first will be provided that. Second, provided further. Third is also. Fourth also. Fifth also. That's how the wordings are. So what is a proviso? You add this exception, give 2 examples, sorted, 4 marks in your pocket. Old syllabus, guys. New syllabus, guys, you just have to, it's shifted to IPCC, new syllabus. So the dangerous things now, danger is the guys who studied IPCC old and who are studying CA final new. Because his interpretation of statute is now not there. It was not there in IPCC old also, it's not there in new also. But if you don't study this, you are doomed. You can't study any law. So, new syllabus, guys, along with the class only, I'll do. Old syllabus, guys, bumper. Whatever I do along the class, accumulate everything. That will be your interpretation of statutes chapter. Right? So, it's the almost the same. No need to worry. 15 hours extra, I'll give you. Yes. So, can do. Now, coming to this proviso, let's see. The board shall not exercise. See, in 179.1, I told, board can exercise. Here I am telling board cannot exercise. So obviously it's an exception. Correct? No. The board shall not exercise any power to do any act or thing which is directed or required, whether under this act or by memorandum or articles or otherwise, to be exercised or done by company in general meeting. Company in general meeting generally means, you know, in IPC it's for shareholders. They are trying to tell in simple words, however, board of directors cannot do some things in simple words we'll write, cannot do some things which the shareholders can do in general meeting. First dialogue, full josh, whatever the company could have done, who can do? Board. Second dialogue, reverse, board cannot do those things which the shareholders can do. Shareholders' powers are given in that proviso very clearly, saying it should be part of AOA, or it should be part of MOA, or it should be part of the Act. That's it. Which means shareholders' powers are limited to AOA, MOA, Act. AOA, MOA, Act. Let's stick to the Act itself. Later we'll go to AOA, MOA. If Act says some things are to be done by board only, like we already saw here in this first example, 179.3, who should do? Only board. If Act says something should be done by shareholders only, can the board interfere? No. Got? Why? Because there's a proviso which clearly says those things which are given to the shareholders only have to be done only by the shareholders. We'll take a simple example, 169.1. That is removal of director. Do not worry about section number. Do not worry about interconnection. This is just an example. I'll only show it to you. 169. A company may, by ordinary resolution, remove a director. That's it. Can board interfere? Never. Only the director can be removed only by shareholders by an ordinary resolution. That's it. That's the end of it. So, this is that proviso which says an act has given specific power to shareholders. Board has no say in it. Which means 169.1 shall be done only by shareholders, and that too they have given resolution also, ordinary resolution. Can you insist for special resolution? No. Why? Act has given ordinary resolution. You cannot make things more restrictive. Done. So this is the scene. 169.1 says ordinary resolution. So first example was 179.3, where board is given the power by the act. Second example is this. No problem. Is there a chance where sometimes both should do? Both. Like board also will come, shareholders also will come. Both will have to do? Yes. Like for example, I'll just take one example, 180 subsection 1. What did I tell? Act, if it gives to the power to the board only, shareholders have no power. First example. Second example, act it gives to the shareholders means board have no power. Third, I'm asking, if act gives the power, board to be done by board and shareholders, both have to do. Example for this is this one, 180 subsection 1. I'll just show you. As I told you, so many interconnections, you will get confused. It's okay, no problem, no one cares. It'll all come back later. 181. Now you see, just the wordings will see. The board of directors of the company shall exercise the following. Which means what? Board has to do it. Only with the consent of the company by a special resolution. This goes hand in hand. Only board resolution, no use. Only special resolution by shareholders, no use. Only when both of them combine, only then whatever is there in A, B, C, D, so many provisions are there. Correct? This, especially for example, this C, no? C in the last three attempts, 16 marks has been asked in this C. And the actual answer is the first line that we are reading now. Correct? So the board of directors of the company will solve all those questions, no problem. The board of directors of the company shall exercise the following powers only with the consent of company by special resolution. Means, what I am saying is here, 180 subsection 1, this one should obviously be both board of directors and shareholders. Act gives power to board, shareholders nowhere to be concerned. Act gives power to shareholders, board not concerned. Act sometimes give to both. Now my question is very simple. What if the act is silent? Act doesn't tell anything. For example, you would have heard in IPCC, you know, notice of the meeting. You would have heard, notice should be given 21 clear days before the meeting. So if you see that section, same dialogue is there. Notice should be given 21 clear days before the meeting. 101. General meeting of a company may be called by giving not less than clear 21 days notice. In these three lines, have they given who should give? You would have vaguely remember in IPCC, meeting can be called by board also, meeting can be called by shareholders also, meeting can be called by tribunal also. You would have heard something, you would have remembered vaguely. Now tell me, who should give notice? The guys who call the meeting should give notice, or when the act is silent, what should I follow? Now 179.1, that first dialogue will come. Whatever the company could have done, if company had brains of its own, will now be done by board only. So think about it. If a shareholder wants to call a meeting, he will just inform the board, and board has to call. The notice cannot be given by shareholder. It's not his right. It's not his duty also. It's the duty of the board. Where is it coming from? This section is silent here. That's why beauty is 179. Who should give the, what do you say, this thing? Notice, company. Who is the company? When nothing is given, board. When something is given, shareholder. So company is interchangeable between board and shareholders. So in one, this one, board of directors shall be entitled to exercise all powers as the company is authorized to exercise and do. So for example, in this example, notice, ideally when you ask any random person who should give notice, you will say company. Now I'll ask, who is company, shareholders or board? That's why 179 says it is the board. You will say, but till today, whenever I said company, I always meant shareholders. Correct? No? No. If it is given, it is shareholders. Yes, it is shareholders. If it is nothing is given, then board. When they say company in general meeting, company in general meeting, then it means shareholders. So can I say this entire law is such so beautiful that this concept of company only is divided by, into two things now. One is board, one is shareholders. Right? It's divided into two. When I simply say company, I don't know, I have to see the section. That's what I'm saying, I have to see the section. If it says company in general meeting, then shareholders. If I say company, nothing else, I have to see the context also. Then it is always the board. So in 101, who should give the notice? Board. There is a case also on this, LIC versus Escorts. The shareholder sent the notice for the meeting. He didn't give any reasons. For example, explanatory statement. No, explanatory statement. 102 is the explanatory statement. That also is a weird section. Nothing is given. A statement setting out material facts concerning each item should be sent. That's it. Who should send? God only knows. So, the shareholder called a meeting once. He didn't give any explanatory statement. The board copy-pasted the same and gave a notice. Notice they gave. This explanatory statement they didn't give. That meeting was void ab initio. Why? Explanatory statement only was not given. Company said, why should I give? The court said, you should only give. Why? It is silent. This all read to 179. 179 is rightfully the mother section of Companies Act. Students don't even study that. That's the best part. We ignore our mothers. Generally, we take them for granted, no? Even me, I'm sure even you, we take our mothers for granted. So, because of this only. This here also, we have taken the mother for granted. 179 is the mother section, which actually gives proper power. Who should do what? Your entire company law is based on resolution only, no? What are the provisions to be followed? Who should pass resolution? If you don't know the mother section only, what's the point? Isn't the law like that? What is the provision of law to be followed? Means what resolution should you pass? I should know the law. This is 179. So, board, sometimes shareholders. Now, here we missed out one part. No, here I remember I told you, board cannot do some things which the shareholders can do. Fair enough. Shareholders, I said, power can be given in AOA, MOA, Act. Act, I gave you example now. removal of director example we took. What about AOA and MOA? My question is, can AOA and MOA override the act? Or is act supreme? For example, if company law removal of director says company in general meeting should pass an ordinary resolution, can the article say no, no, it should be special resolution? No. So we have again in IPCC section 6, first line only says very clearly, section 6, act to override memorandum articles etc. Act to override memorandum articles etc. So it says provisions of this act shall have effect notwithstanding anything to the contrary contained in the memorandum or articles. Means what? If ulta is given in the MOA AOA, ignore it. Who will be supreme act? So I can say that AOA and MOA should always act within the parameters of the act. So if act is there, supreme power, act, AOA, MOA are well within it always. Among AOA, MOA, who is more powerful, we'll see later. But basically, act is supreme. You should always do everything within the act. However, if I take one example, simple example of quorum, quorum of general meeting, that is given in section 103. These examples I have already taken. No? For example, if 169(1) removal of director says, for removal of director you have to pass ordinary resolution, the AOA cannot say no, no, I have to pass special resolution. Wrong. Not possible. But I am just taking one more random example here. 103 quorum. 103 quorum. If I check that here, in case of public company, quorum they will give 5 members personally present, 15 members personally present, 30 members personally present. 5 members if the number of members is not more than 1000. So any company where the, what do you say, number of members is less than or equal to 1000, what should be the quorum? 5. My question is, can the article say, no, no, it should be 10? The thing is, for these questions, you need to see the first line in the section. Previously, I asked you, can articles override the act? You said no. Correct. But now, if you see, unless the articles of the company provide for a larger number, means what? Articles can articles say 2? No. Is this act overriding the articles or articles overriding the act? Articles overriding the act. But who is giving the power? Act. And isn't it weird? Right? So general rule is what? General rule is 100% you're right. Act, AOA and MOA will definitely override. Will override, will not override? AOA, MOA will override the act or act will override? Yes, AOA and MOA will not override the act, or other way around, act will override AOA, MOA. The Companies Act will override AOA and MOA, that is for sure. Companies Act will override AOA and MOA. But there are certain peculiar sections like this, 103, where act, it's a very peculiar scenario concept, act gives the power to the AOA or MOA to override the act itself. Weird. To override the act itself. Which means, I read section 6. We all read section 6. Section 6, what did it say? Act will override AOA, MOA. Is this always correct or are there exceptions? There are exceptions. General rule, act will always override AOA, MOA. But there are exceptions where sometimes AOA and MOA will override the act. But the beauty of this entire thing is, who gives the power? Act. One more example we can take. One more example. Let's take Yeah, 60, we'll take bonus, 63, bonus shares. 63, bonus shares, issue of bonus share, in that subsection 2. No company shall capitalize its profits or reserves for the purpose of issuing fully paid bonus shares unless it is authorized by articles. Unless it is authorized by articles. Means what? Here they are telling Act will apply only if AOA provides. This is which one? Bonus 63 2A. Act is giving power to the articles to override the Act. Act says, please open the articles and see if there is a line which says company can issue bonus shares. If that line is not there, Act is telling I am not applicable. But this, both these things go contrary to section 6. Section 6 says Act will override the articles. But in these two different examples, we have seen articles can override the Act. Articles can override the Act, because in the second example, if articles are silent or articles specifically mention the company cannot issue bonus shares, that's it. Company cannot give bonus shares. Or if the articles are silent also, you cannot issue bonus shares. It's weird. Cannot issue bonus shares. So what I am trying to tell is, Act will apply only if the AOA permits. This runs contrary to our section 6, where we had already read that who will override who? Act will override MOA. But you see this first line. Whenever Act uses the word save as, it means except. Except. Except otherwise means what? Otherwise means ulta, reverse. Reverse is expressly provided in this Act. This is again old syllabus fellows, they'll ask you. Save as, otherwise expressly. What do you mean by this provision? Explain. So for them, bumper 4 marks. For new syllabus guys, no, you just have to understand the meaning and keep quiet. That's it. But for old syllabus, extra 4 marks they can get. So save as means what? Except. Otherwise means what? Ulta. What is the real law? This law only. Act to override memorandum or articles. Except those cases where ulta is expressly given in the Act. What is ulta? AOA MOA will override the Act. Where is it given? Already we saw, no? One is 103, quorum. Where articles can give a larger quorum. Second is bonus. Two examples are enough. There are so many, 68 2A, 55 2, so many, leave it. Ulta is what? MOA, AOA will override the Act. It's a weird thing. But again, Bayer Act is giving the power. Save as, otherwise, expressly provided in this Act. So general rule is this. I have to search for exception. So every section I have to see if there are any exceptions like that. All this will come in my director's chapter. Who will appoint directors? Board or shareholders? Doubtful. Some shareholders, some directors can be appointed by board. Some can be appointed by shareholders. Who are those type of directors? And those who are appointed by shareholders, can board appoint if the exception is given? All that are only the question paper questions. Nobody will give direct questions. So, of late, especially since May 16, they have changed the way they are asking questions. And it is based on these only. That's why we have to do these basics very, very clearly. Got it? It has still not under, I have still not answered the question. This is done. Shareholders can do in GM. Who will give the power? Act. Or AOA, MOA. And we have already understood, will AOA, MOA override the Act? No. But in exceptional circumstances, definitely AOA, MOA will override the Act. But the beauty is, Act only has given power. Act only has given the power to override the AOA and MOA. Correct? As a child, could you have slapped your dad? No, I'll say you can't, but I'm just saying. Could you have slapped? No. But what if your dad only allows you? You play with me, you slap me today, no problem. That's it. Your mother and your dad is your Act. generally you are not allowed to do it. You are AO, MOA. But if they allow you, no problem, do it. Then you can do it. That is nothing but those sections. 103, correct, 55-2, 63-2A. Section number, you leave it. But still, till now also, I have not answered the question. What is my question? Who is more powerful? I don't know. No, but sometimes shareholders only have the power, no? But actually, overall, if you see, it appears that, okay, board. Because in silence also, you have the power. It appears that it is the board. But we don't know whether it's the board or whether it's the shareholders. So, to make matters, I mean, clear, let's say all of you are, you know, the shareholders of this company, Advait Learning Limited, assume. So, you are the shareholders. Now, you come in and you sit here. I'm the company secretary. So, I'm very happy that you have come. This is your company. You have built this. So, basically, every rupee that you have given has been spent to build all these things. No problem. You will just say, anyway, it's February, man. Just show me the accounts. I just want to see. I'm very curious to know. Just show me. I'll just see and go. Nothing else. I'll not do anything. So, you will come, I'll just give you a pleasure, I'll give you lunch to eat, all that, I'll treat you really well. I'm the company secretary, I'll treat you really well because you are the owner, or the owner of the company. Then when you say, okay, give me the, I just want to see the books, that's it. And you are not saying, I'm going to analyze everything. I said, just tell me the profit figure, how are we doing, because I haven't come here since a long time, just tell me. Company secretary, I'm the company, I'll say, sir, you have eaten everything properly now, I've treated you well, get out. You get agitated. You said, boss, I am the 100% shareholder here. I am not asking anything. I am just telling, tell me the figures. I just want to see the books. Again, company secretary, sir, I have already told you. You have come, you have given money, that's okay. Solomon versus Solomon in CPT you had studied. Correct? Separate legal entity. You have given money, yes, I have given the respect, now get out. But you say, boss, I am the owner. The chair that you are sitting on is because of me. I am not asking anything. I am just saying, I just show me the accounts. Company secretary, watchman, get out. I will bring the watchman and throw you out. Am I right? Company secretary is right or shareholder? What do you think? Company secretary is right or shareholder? You just ask for the accounts. That's it. Nothing else. So, we have a section, right? It's section 128. We have a section 128. Books of accounts. In the old syllabus, fellows will get this in law. New syllabus, law and auditing. 128.3. Old syllabus, law and auditing. New syllabus, only auditing. Sorry. Not law. In law, it won't come for new syllabus. The books of accounts and other books and papers maintained by the company within India shall be open for inspection at the registered office. So, you as a shareholder will be very happy to see this. Of the company or such other place, by, now all down, by any director. You are searching, member, shareholder, nothing is given. Inspection can be done only and only by director. So, the company secretary will ask, sir, you are just a shareholder, please get out. See, you are the owners of the company, will tell, no, what owners, you can't even see the books. 128.3 says shareholder cannot see the books of accounts, only and only director. When act has given power to the director, only director can do it. But isn't it unfair? You practically gave the full capital. Company is standing there because of you, your money, and you can't have any access. So, this shareholder went to MC and said, what is this nonsense? I don't have any powers. You simply call me shareholder, no power. So, MCA said, no, you are not reading the act properly. You should see, you have four insane powers, superpowers basically. You will ask, what superpower I have? They will say, first point, who can check the books of accounts? You or, I mean, who can inspect according to that section? Directors. Second question MC asks, who can appoint the director? Correct? Got the point. Who can appoint the shareholders? Who can appoint the director? So that is there. 152 is that section. Section number you ignore, guys. I'll show it to you. So many interconnections are there, you'll get confused. It's okay. You ignore this first dialogue. You already know this first dialogue, no, no? You ignore. Every director shall be appointed by company in general meeting. That's it. Over. But unless ulta is given. So that is what your Companies Act is all about. Directors chapter. Ulta means what? Can board appoint? Can somebody else appoint? Can board appoint? Yes. Can somebody else appoint? Yes. Who is that somebody else? I am ICICI Bank. I'll give you 100 crore loan. I'll say appoint. I don't care, appoint. I want one person on the board. Can they do it? Yes. Only because of this line, guys. Save as otherwise expressly provided. Otherwise, who has the power? Every director shall be appointed by company. That's it. No other answer. Which means they say he can check the books, but who can appoint him? You. 152.2. Read with 160. 160 is the procedure. We'll see that later. Appointment of director provisions you have. Nobody else has. Brilliant. You can appoint. Nobody else can appoint. Second, you don't like that fellow. Can you throw him out? I already seen, no? 169. I gave you an example already. 169. Removal of director can only and only be done by shareholders. Can only be done by shareholders. Then you will say, okay, I'll inspect the accounts and all that, but I am not able to check the accounts. Give me something where to check the accounts. I want to check it properly. He says, MCA says, boss, you are just one shareholder. If you want to check the accounts, people die for 5 years. They literally die and then they rise from the ashes. Who are they? So they say, you go to this Malleshwaram, 7th cross, you have this proper CTR dosa. From basement, people will come out, completely reborn. Correct? You catch hold of them, only those people can actually check the accounts. You don't have the caliber, I'm sorry. For you to have the caliber, you obviously have to struggle for 5 years. That's the reason why we are sitting. So, you have so much respect. Chartered accountants have so much respect because of section 139. That is chapter 10, audit and auditors. Every company shall appoint an auditor. So, what is the source section for 139? It is actually 128.3. The lack of power at the hands of the shareholders to inspect the accounts has given rise to this. This is the reason why you get, as a statutory auditor, you get coffee, tea every half an hour. Why? Because of this section. Correct? Correct? No. As a statutory auditor, you will get coffee, tea every half an hour. First only when they come, they'll call you sir, madam. Though we are not chartered accountants, for article clerk, they'll give respect. For 3 years, you have had no respect, but suddenly somebody will call us sir, madam and all that. Correct? But if you're an internal auditor, they'll look at you and drink tea. They'll not give tea. Why? Because that's not part of this chapter at all. That's 138. 138 is chapter number 9, management. It's your accounts. You're under the management. So they'll look at you and they'll just drink tea on their own. I have I had a student who sent me a picture. He was an internal auditor. His associate was a statutory auditor. Same day, he got half tea. His friend got watermelon juice. Think about it. He sent me a picture. Difference. The difference is one section. 138 and 139. But between one section, there's a huge chapter difference. Chapter 9 and chapter 10. So if you see this section here. So I tell the MCA tells, go to Malleshwaram, 7th cross. From basement you wait, they'll come. They are what? Section 139, appointment of auditors. I told you 7th cross, you went to 15th cross, 9th cross, other places also people will be coming out, no? So there you appointed and you found them not worthy of being appointed. So can you throw them out? MCA says, I told you to go to 7th cross, why did you go to 15th cross? Why did you go to 9th cross? Why did you go to Jayanagar? I told you Malleshwaram only, no? Go to Malleshwaram, 7th cross. So I can remove, that is section 140, removal of auditors. These powers can only be done by you. That's what they say. You are crying saying that board has powers, but my dear friend, you have superpowers. Nobody can touch it. Can AOA say board can do it? No. Can board pass a resolution saying that we have to interfere? No. These are four superpowers given by MCA, by the law. These four superpowers are called pillars of corporate democracy. It is nothing but a democracy. One share, one vote. One person, one vote is generally democracy, but here it is one share, one vote. One share, one vote. Right? You have 20 shares, 20 votes. You hold 30% shareholding, 30% vote you can do. These pillars cannot be touched. These pillars cannot be played around with. You have supreme power in doing this. That is the beauty of this law. So from now, every question has to be analyzed from 179 point of view. And your entire law is nothing but this only. What is the procedure? I have to figure out, should I pass board resolution? Should I pass shareholder resolution? Should I pass both? That's why Bayer Act, if you read, you will get clarity. Now you will never have any problem. Right? This is the issue. This is point number one. Next, link to this. Now think about it, guys. Now think about it. You have so many things, right? What is there in this actually? You have, first of all, you have auditors provisions here. Flowing from this is auditors. Flowing from this is directors. Directors. Third one, what is the point of contention? Whether I can check accounts or not check accounts. That also is sorted. Fourth, why am I investing in the company? To get dividend. So MCA says, from arising from these pillars only, if I can satisfy these four things, will you be happy? As a shareholder, you will say, yes, I am happy. That is why these four things are called ordinary business. Ordinary business is these four only, no? What are the four things you want? They'll ask the shareholder. You can get to choose to appoint the auditor, choose to appoint the director. Then you can get to see the accounts. Who will check the accounts, inspect the account, inspect the accounts? Director. Who will audit the accounts? Auditor. Both you only appointed. That's the best part. Ultimately, they will do all the work and come and lay everything in front of you. Correct? When will they lay everything in front of you? And one meeting you come every year. That is called annual general meeting. And they come in front of you and lay everything in front of you. You check, you see, okay, fine. You say, okay. That's it. And they'll give you some money for your money that you have spent. That's called dividend. That is why it is called as ordinary business. Link to this is the concept of those three things which we'll finish and then we can take that lunch break. Okay, so quickly. So in the exam, everything is based on these three things. We should know what are these. And our unfortunately our basics are little weak. We'll strengthen it, no problem. So they will, we should know what is ordinary business, what is special business. We should know what is ordinary resolution and what is special resolution. And we should know what is ordinary notice and special notice. Special notice provision I will do later. That requires some analysis. Other things are very simple. We'll quickly finish it off. Tell me guys, what do you mean by one more thing? Does ordinary business require ordinary resolution? And does ordinary resolution require ordinary notice? Or all are different? Yes. So this is one part, this is one part, this is one part. Nothing is interlinked. You can never interlink it. It will be wrong. There are cases where ordinary business requires special resolution. There are cases where special business requires ordinary resolution. There are cases where special business requires ordinary notice. There are cases where special business requires special notice. Later we will take all the examples. First we should know what are those things, right? So we need to understand what do you mean by this business. Business. So business is divided into two, ordinary and special. We have already discussed the ordinary businesses are those four businesses. If you like Saurav Ganguly, they are the Dada points. Or in Kannada, we call our friends, come to the usual Adda to discuss. That is Adda points. Director, accounts, dividend auditors or accounts director dividend auditors, doesn't matter, same. These are stemming from what? The pillars of corporate democracy anyway. This is given in section 102, subsection 2. Clause A to be specific. 102, subsection 2, clause A. To be specific. So let's just quickly go through that section. 102. Check it out. 102, subsection 2. In case of annual general meeting, all the businesses to be transacted shall be deemed to be special other than these four. So financial statement is nothing but accounts, declaration of dividend, appointment of director, appointment of auditor. Now I asked you a question before I did all these basics. Now you will 100% answer. I asked you a question, if the dividend is happening at EGM, is it ordinary or special? If dividend is declaring, is being declared, theoretically I am asking, if dividend is being declared at an extraordinary general meeting, ordinary business or special business? If the financial statements are being approved at an EGM, that's why Bear Act, read, in the case of annual general meeting, all businesses to be transacted are actually special, except these four. Next line, in case of any other meeting, all businesses, including the four, that is not there, interpretation, all businesses, including the four, shall be deemed to be special. Got it? This one point they'll play around with you in the MCQ. What will you do? That's the thing. Approval of financial statements in extraordinary general meeting is dash, ordinary, special, extraordinary. All that they'll ask. So it is a special business. So rather than concentrating on those dada points, adda points, what we need to see is if the dada or adda points happen at AGM, only then it is ordinary. Those are the keywords. Now after today you need not read the Bear Act, because I am reading it in the class only. It will be a waste of time if you go home and again analyze the Bear Act. Bear Act should be analyzed only when there is doubt. But now I am teaching you the art of reading. That is the most important thing. With this art, with these 8 days, you can read any Bear Act in the world. That's my assurance. Right? And it should be read like that. In the case of annual general meeting, all businesses to be transacted thereat shall be deemed to be special. Okay. Other than, means my keyword is AGM and these four will be ordinary. Correct? No? Which means that is understood. I don't even have to see the second one. If the same four happen in any other meeting, it will be special. That is understood. But that still they have given. In case of any other meeting, all business shall be deemed to be special. So there are only two types of meeting, AGM and EGM. So ordinary business is the dada points or adda points at AGM. So special will be what? The same dada points if it happens at EGM would be special. Second one, if dada only is special, other than dada will also be special only, no? Other than dada points also, other than the dada points at EGM will obviously be special. What about other than dada points at AGM? Special, obviously. When dada at AGM is only ordinary, other than dada at AGM also will be special. Other than dada points at AGM will be special. Rather than remembering this, just remember this. No, that's done. Adda or dada points at AGM will be ordinary. That's it. Everything else is special. What are special? These three things. That's it. This is the concept of ordinary business and special business. People think that reading Bear Act is difficult and you will get confused more. No, it is the contrary. It will give you a lot of clarity. Just initial that, you know, 1 day, 2 days to get adjusted, you will take time. Many people after this first session only will run away. But it should not be the case, because I am telling you, keep patience. Whatever we connected, everything will come back when we do the provisions. Because then I will not tell what is ordinary business. I'll just say this. They'll ask you what is ordinary or special. You should tell me. Amalgamation, discussion on amalgamation happening at AGM. Ordinary or special?
Special.
That old auditor died. Now you will not give me the wrong answer at all. Old auditor died. New auditor had to be appointed at EGM. That's it. Dividend could not be declared at AGM. They held, this is theoretical. It actually happens at the AGM, but this part is theoretical. But they held an EGM and declared dividend. Special. That's all. So, including ADDA points, any business at EGM will be special. Simple. The moment you see EGM, everything will be special. That is business. Now coming to resolution. Quickly, resolution. Any doubts in this? Simple, right? Resolution. Resolution is of two types. I asked you before only those, is it minus, is it greater than, equal to, all that. Resolution is ordinary resolution, special resolution. Ordinary, special. Tell me guys, what do you mean by ordinary? This is covered in 114 subsection 1. Special resolution, 114 subsection 2. Simple. Ordinary resolution is majority or more than half, more than 51%. When you say majority, what majority can be anything. Even 70% majority is a majority. More than half. More than half. So the wordings, if you read quickly, 1141. Wordings say, a resolution shall be ordinary if the notice required under this act has been duly given. Okay. This all you leave. The votes cast in favor of the resolution, including the casting vote so and so, shall exceed the votes cast against. When the votes cast for is more than the votes cast against, which means more than half only, no? Correct? More than half. Simple majority. The votes cast for should be more than the votes cast against. Simple majority. Now, again, here you think about it. There are 1,200 people in the company. 1,000 are equity shareholders. 200 are preference shareholders. For an ordinary resolution to be passed, is it 501 or 601? Why? What do you think? Why? So preference shareholders cannot vote? Is it 601 or 501? For an ordinary resolution to be passed, 501, that is out of 1000, or 1200 divided by 2, 601, majority. Why not 601? You are right, 501 is the correct answer. Now tell me, why not 601? Preference shareholder does not have voting right. In 1141, you tell me, we are reading the Bear Act, no? In this full 5 lines, where will you show me which says it should be done only by equity shareholders? I am telling you 501 is correct answer, which means you don't have to go anywhere else. 501 is correct. You need to tell me the logic. Yes, this line here. So entitled. No need to go to voting. So entitled. Entitled is a right or duty? The moment I see entitled, I should wake up and think about IPCC syllabus. In IPCC, we discussed, we had seen something called voting rights. Correct? This is the key word here, entitled. That's it. So this entire thing can be broken down into what? First of all, votes cast for must be more than votes cast against. Should I write these keywords? I mean, what I am trying to tell is, one more question you may ask. Should I write exactly the way it is given in the Bear Act? Even the lawmaker can't write it. That you need to understand. So we need to just write the keywords. Right? So I had asked you, what are the problems that you are facing? You told technical words, I can't remember. If you read the Bear Act, I can assure you, you can remember. Correct? So the votes cast for is more than votes cast against. Instead of that, you can simply say more than half. It's okay. That's what I am trying to tell. No need to exactly write the same thing. You can write more than half. But what is the key thing? Those who are entitled only. Everyone can't vote, no? That's the key word that we miss out. Simple majority will write. Of whom? Of the ones who are entitled to vote. Who are those fellows? If you see voting rights in the Companies Act 47, again, section number not needed, I'm just telling. Section number, it's very clear, it says, every member of a company limited by shares and holding equity share capital shall have a right to vote on every resolution. There ends the matter. Every member of the company holding equity share capital shall have a right to vote on every resolution. Next question. After seeing this line, can every member of a company hold other than equity share capital also? By seeing this line, how will you interpret? This line says every member of the company holding equity capital. Can I say every member of the company not holding equity capital, that is preference share capital? Yes. So what I am trying to ask second round is, does member include preference shareholder also? Yes. So from now, wherever you see the word member, it should be equity shareholder and preference shareholder. This will come in class action suit, compromise arrangement, operation mismanagement. They will give in the exam this only. Preference shareholder applied for operation mismanagement. No, he cannot do. He doesn't have voting power. The keyword there was member, not voting rights. Got it? That's why it is so important to read the WARE Act. Because it says every member of the company limited by shares and holding equity capital. Then you see here, every member of the company limited by shares and holding preference share capital. Only given. Means member means what? Equity and preference. What's the difference in member and shareholder? Can it be used interchangeably? Is every member a shareholder? Or is every shareholder a member? Every shareholder is a member. My great grandfather had shares. In the nominee form, he had written my name. Today he passed away. His name is mentioned in the register as a shareholder. Correct? And member, obviously. He passed away. Shares have come to me now. I still haven't gone to the company and registered the transfer or transmission. Correct? But I have the shares right now. I have control. Am I the shareholder? Yes. Shareholder is a person who holds the shares. That's it. I have given money to you, right? You have bought the shares. Shares have been allotted to you. Are you the shareholder? Yes. But who's the benefit going to me? Going to whom? Me. I am the significant shareholder, beneficial shareholder, so to speak. Got it? So shareholder is a person who holds the shares. That's it. So, am I a member? No. But am I a shareholder? In my uncle, I mean my great-grandfather example, yes. I am a shareholder but not a member. When will I be a member? When my name has been entered in the register of members. Got it? That's how it works. On the other hand, is every member a shareholder? Company limited by guarantee. There is no concept of shares only. So there, whoever tells this amount I will pay at the time of winding up will be a member, but it will never be a shareholder because it's a company limited by guarantee. Both are different. But in Company Act, we generally use it interchangeably while writing because here member, shareholder, but there are differences is what I'm saying. There are differences between member and shareholder. Now, so here, what am I saying? Entitled. So you are saying only 1000 means 501, you are absolutely right. Now, in this 1000, only 800 come for the meeting, 200 bunk. 501, 401. That is, you know, common sense, obviously, because in your normal voting also, voter turnout will be some 30%. Correct? So, whoever gets majority in that 30% will become minister. So, same thing. That's fine. Now, one more question. 800 come. 600 vote, 200 only come and eat properly and go. 301 or 401? From here, where do you see? Yes, that's it. Perfect. Those of you who have never touched the WARE Act, you have already become a decoder. Honestly, by, because by, just by reading. You all know it, just that we don't do it, that's it. We all know. Deep down inside, it's already there, the analytical mind. We need to come out of that. Why this analysis is important is, in the exam, if I am the evaluator, I'll only see two words. Three things. First, for is greater than against. You can write in any language, more than half, whatever. Second, entitled. Third, voting. That's it. You write these three, full marks. And without reading the Bayer Act, it's impossible to get this. From today, will I touch the Bayer Act in this section? No. I already know the keywords. No, why should I go? Only if I have a doubt, I'll go. Otherwise, no. That's it. These are the keywords that the fellow who's evaluating will see. Entitled means he has to have the right. Voting rights as per 47 we saw. And voting means the guys who abstained from voting should not be counted. These three rules only is there everywhere. Operation mismanagement, then everything, your compromise arrangement. So the guys who cannot, won't come for the meeting cannot be counted. Unless it's clearly given so. Based on this, so many questions. Now what is special resolution then? I asked you, more than 75? Greater than equal to 75? This is more than 50 it has become now. Is that more than 75? I'll show you the section, you only tell me. Without even reading it for the first, I think probably you are reading this section for the first time. This section, Bayer Act. You would have read the textbook, Bayer Act probably first time. Tell me, you only tell me, is it greater than or equal to 75? Where is 75 given first of all? Yes, the votes cast in favor must be three times, must be. Not less than means what? Greater than or equal to. Correct, no? Which means it is at least, you can read, at least. The votes cast in favor must be three times the votes cast against. Means if one fellow says no, three fellows should say yes. The votes cast in favor must be three times the votes cast against. Out of the four votes, three out of four votes should say yes. That's why that 75% rule came. You are opening and searching 75%, it's not there. Correct, no? In the exam, should I write all this dialogue? No need. You can simply write 3/4 majority, no problem. Should I write copy-paste exactly? No need at all. You can simply write 3/4 majority. You can simply write 75%. No problem. Now tell me. Now you will never forget. Is it greater than or equal to 75 or greater than 75? Yes, at least. Not less than is greater than or equal to 75%. Exactly 75 if you get. Answer. Special resolution passed. But still we are wrong. We will just, you just saw the three things. You didn't see the first two things at all. The intention, first of all, notice should be given properly, as duly given. You have remembered in IPCC 21 clear days before the meeting. Think about it. If you have not given 21 days before and still 90% people pass, is it a valid special resolution? No. All the three conditions to be followed. See, it's and three are given together. All three should be followed. We only write the third point and come wrong answer. Third point is the voting. What are the first two things? Notice must be given. So when anyone asks you what is special resolution, three keywords. First one, notice should be given as per 101 properly followed. We haven't done this. Now we'll do. That's before the break. Second one, you see the first line. Intention to propose the resolution as a special resolution has been duly specified. In the notice, you should explicitly mention that the intended resolution is a special resolution. If you do not mention this, gone. Third one is voting 3/4. Now tell me, notice has not been sent properly. It was sent some 15 days before the meeting. 90% say yes. Gone. Void ab initio. Notice was sent 21 days before only, okay. But in the notice, you did not mention what type of resolution it is. 93% said yes to that resolution. Void ab initio. All the three have to be followed. So this is the keyword. When I am reading special resolution, so many places you will see special resolution And in the question, they'll ask you, explain the procedure. I cannot write special resolution has to be passed. I should say, notice as per the act has to be duly given. Second, the intention should be special resolution. Third one, 3/4 majority. This is a 4-mark question where they'll ask you drafting. Drafting will come both in old and new syllabus. No, no. Is it special notice? No. Notice can be special, can be ordinary. But you should just say notice should be given as per the act. If it is given under 101, it's ordinary notice. If it is given under 115, it is special notice. Both are different. Special notice is different, ordinary notice is different. That's what I told you. Special resolution, special notice, wrong answer. Correct? If you write special notice should be given, special 2 marks will be deducted. Correct? Simple. So that's the thing. So notice has to be given as per the act. Could be ordinary notice or special notice. Second, notice should, intended resolution must be special. So if you, I mean, pick up any, what do you say? One second. If you pick up any, notice of any company for that matter. Infosys. Check it out. See, they will specify clearly ordinary business. Hadda points. Then special business. Then you see, to consider and thought fit, ordinary resolution. Here, see, consider and thought fit, pass a special resolution. If this is not given, then in this whatever, purchase of healthcare business, 98.99% people agree at the meeting, but this is not given in the notice. Void ab initio. Remaining 1% can go and lodge a complaint, that entire resolution will be struck down. Correct? So that is why it is very essential. Even if you don't write this ordinary resolution, it's okay. But see, they have divided into ordinary business, special business. Ordinary business, special business. That is why it is important to understand that. So last part before the break is this, which is that ordinary notice. Special notice later. This is the resolution part. Very simple. Ordinary and special. Only the keywords. Now coming to notice. Only we'll stick to ordinary notice. And this is under section 101. Special notice we'll see later. Ordinary notice. Who will give? We already discussed. Board. A general meeting of a company may be called. A general meeting. A general meeting means any general meeting. General meeting is of two types. AGM, EGM. That's it. AGM and EGM. When I wrote IPCC, after writing also, I thought there are three types of general meeting. AGM, EGM, OGM. Ordinary general meeting, extraordinary, then annual. That's why I got 42. No wonder. Right? That's why I am saying we should read the Bear Act. A general meeting. Only two types. AGM, EGM. May be called by giving not less than clear 21 days notice in writing. So they say, who should give? We know now. Board. When act is silent, who will give? Board. Board will give notice. 21 clear days before the meeting. Whenever I say a company, we figured it out. A company means any company. Whenever they said every company, in auditor's provision we saw, every company shall appoint auditor. Every means all. Whatever you can think of. Did you use any great interpretation technique here? No. You literally constructed it. Literally saw the meaning. Literal meaning of every is every. Literal meaning of a is what? All types. 90% of our interpretation is based on this rule called litera legis. Also called literal construction. All of us should know this. Old syllabus bumper. 4 marks they'll give. Explain litera legis with an example. That's it. Litera legis means literal construction, literal interpretation. 90% of our interpretation is always litera legis. When I say a, there is no other meaning to it except a, which is all companies. When I say every, there is no other meaning to it. It's every company. Private, public, small company, OPC, so many companies are there. But here, what is the literal meaning of clear? That's the best part. It's unclear. What is the literal meaning of clear? When I say 21 clear days, no, I'm generally asking literal meaning of clear. Clear days means what? Is it exactly 24 hours a day? Or should it be Sundays are excluded? Can you literally construct it without any doubt? If I tell you what is clear date, clear days, no. The meaning of clear is actually unclear. So I told you 90% of the time we use litera legis. When litera legis fails, I have to go towards other interpretation techniques. And the best interpretation is to go by the intention. When I tell 21 days before the meeting, the law's intention is like today I am sending. Do you count today or from tomorrow you should count? Logically. Today I can send at 10, I can send at 12, I can send just before the office closes, 5:30. So will I count today? Will it make sense? No. And when I say before the meeting, meeting is at 10. Before the meeting is 9:59:59 seconds. Or when I say before the meeting, that meeting day you exclude. What makes sense? Yes. So when litera legis fails, I have to go by the intention of law. And when I go by the intention of law, that construction is called as reasonable construction. Construction means meaning of one word. That's a rule of, that's an interpretation. Reasonable construction is the rule of interpretation, where I go by the intention of law, where I will cover the faulty draftsmanship. This, by inserting the word clear, it's pretty stupid. What is clear? I don't know. It's a faulty way of drafting the law. Even the lawmakers are human beings. There can be mistakes. But the rule of law is, the law never makes mistakes. That's the rule. So when they said clear, it's not a mistake. You are unclear. That's what they are saying. That's why I have to use this reasonable construction. Interpretation of statute is a subject for a judge, not for me. But why should I study this? You have accounting standards, you have auditing standards, you have secretarial standards. Just like that, standards for interpretation is for the judge. But why should we follow? First point of contact is us only. The client will come to you and say, sir, what is this interpretation? I'm not understanding. Sir, I also didn't understand. That's why I left this in the exam. We can't tell. Correct? No, we have to actually interpret. That's why I use reasonable construction. So in reasonable construction, I have to exclude two things: date of meeting and date of sending the notice. Obviously, date of sending the notice. Date of meeting exclude, date of sending the notice exclude. Got it? That's how it is. Using pure common sense, using the intention. On the other hand, Section 20, read with the rules. When I use this, no, R/W, it means read with. Section 20, read with the rules. They say if you are sending anything via post, 48 hours postal transit should be, is deemed. It's always excluded. When I'm sending anything via post, which means what would be clear days? 3rd February if I am sending, 3rd February exclude, 4th February, 5th February exclude. Why? Postal transit. 6th February will be my day 1, 7th February will be day 2. Like that, count 21 days. And the 22nd day will be the day of the meeting. Clear days. Or one more you can do. If you want to count from today only, if you want to count from today, 21 days is anyway there. 2 days I have already excluded here. 2 days I have excluded here. So from today only, if I want to count, count 25 days. 3rd February is day 1, 4th is day 2, 5th is day 3, 6th is day 4, like that. 25th day will be the day of the meeting.
both ways you can do. Today you ignore, fourth and fifth you ignore, sixth will be day one. Like that count 21 days. 22nd day will be the day of the exam, the meeting, exam also, correct, meeting. On the other hand, here if I do from today, same it will come. 21st day, 25th day will be the day of the meeting. Now you tell me, use your logic, common sense. If I am sending the meeting via post, how will I count the day? 21 plus 2 plus 2. If I am sending via email, 21 first plus 2 will come. Will plus 2 come again? No. Email 2 days, email should go transit. No. It is 23 days. You use now. What did you use? You gave effect to section 20 only when applicable. Section 20, 48 hours, you gave only when applicable. Correct? If post, then 2. If no post, no 2. You basically read 101, read with section 20, read with rules. Three things we read now. And you only interpreted beautifully whether it's post means what, mail means what. What did you do? You gave effect to all the sections. Now, for example, in mail, if you are not calculating this 2, are you breaking the law in 20? No. This method of giving effect to all the provisions is called harmonious construction. Explain literal legacy with example, 4 marks. Explain harmonious construction with example, 4 marks. Explain reasonable concept with example, 4 marks. Old syllabus. New syllabus, we have to know, that's all. IPC fellows will write, they will get marks. Correct? But without knowing, we can't interpret. So we have to give effect to all the provision. This will be my what? This thing, what do you say? Clear days, ordinary notice. So we have a couple of other things. Sorry? Harmonious construction. So, for example, in a last part, holding subsidiary relationship, tell me guys, now without seeing, is it more than half? If I am to be called as a subsidiary company, more than half? You are right, more than half. Correct. Of what? I'll give you 4 options. MCQ. Paid up share capital, issued share capital, subscribed share capital, then let's say equity share capital. Paid up, okay. I issued? No. Subscribed? No. Paid up? Wrong. Equity directly they have not given. They have used the words total voting power. This got amended 7th May 2018. Recently. Earlier it was total share capital. That time also you were wrong. With before amendment also wrong only. It's not paid up share capital. Total share capital. Earlier. Total. That is also not there. Now it is total voting. Because total share capital was earlier. Equity share capital plus convertible preference share capital. So if a holding company had your full convertible preference share, but just one equity share, still it would be called as holding company. It was absurd. Let's say subsidiary company had 1 lakh equity share capital, 1 lakh convertible preference share capital, and this holding company is holding 1 lakh equity share cap, sorry, convertible preference share capital and 1 equity share. Without even having voting rights, it is calling itself holding company. It was weird. Correct? That's why they deleted all that. Now it says total voting power. And if you see total voting power, it is nothing but equity share capital. Where you have voting rights. Where will you have voting rights? Equity share capital. Correct? This is given in 2 subsection 87. These 2 points and we are done. Holding company, subsidiary company, I wanted to think. This subsidiary company definition is given in 2 subsection 87. Holding company definition is given in 2 subsection 46. Definitions are generally given in section 2. Subsidiary company is a company in which the other company called holding company holds more than half of TVP. Total voting power. Next question, if holding company holds, not holding, some company H holds in S, let us say 10%. And also holding company has given 100 crore loan. And they have a clause, H company has a clause, out of your 10 directors, I will appoint 6 directors. Is S a subsidiary? Shareholding is only 10. Why? Controls the composition of board of directors. You see 2 subsection 87, it says controls the composition of board of, sorry, of the directors of which company? Controls the composition of directors of which company? The other company. Only then you are called as a subsidiary company. Controls the composition of the board of directors of the other company. And this is most important. It is or, it is not and. Either this or controls more than half of the total voting power. Got it? Is foreign company a company? I asked you. Is foreign company a company? If you see company's definition under 2 subsection 20, 2 subsection 20, company's definition. Company means a company incorporated under this act or under any other previous company law. And they have used the word means. When act uses the word means, it's an exhaustive definition. You cannot go for any other meaning. Exhaustive. If they had changed it to includes, company includes a company incorporated under this act, then you could have said, okay, foreign company is a company. But they are saying company means a company incorporated under this act. So it's Tesla, for example. Is it a foreign company? Yes. But is it a company? No. Why? Company means a company incorporated under Companies Act. So what is Tesla? Yes, body corporate, 2 subsection 11. Because body corporate or corporation includes a company incorporated outside India. Includes a company incorporated outside India. But does not include, all these other things they have given, but includes. So foreign company would be a body corporate, not a company. Not a company. Why I told you this? There's a reason. So subsidiary company, okay, there's a reason why I'm telling you this. Now tell me, if you see 2 subsection 87 ka definition, subsidiary company in relation to any other company means a company in which the holding company controls the composition. Fair enough. Holding company, it says subsidiary company is a company in which the holding company controls the composition or more than half. No problem. Subsidiary company is a company, it says. Does it mean an Indian holding company cannot have a foreign subsidiary? If it has also, is the foreign subsidiary part of Companies Act? Because the definition of subsidiary company says what? Subsidiary company in relation to any other company means a company. Are you getting my point? Foreign subsidiary, is it a company or body corporate? Body corporate. Here it says, in which means a company in which the holding company controls the composition. Correct? So if I am abroad, if a holding company in India is controlling my composition, okay. Or exercising more than half, okay. I am still not a subsidiary because it says company here. That is why explanation, if you see here, think about the brilliance of the lawmaker. For the purposes of this clause, expression company includes body corporate. Got it? Expression company includes body corporate. Means what? Can an Indian company have a foreign subsidiary? Is it controlled under Companies Act? Yes. Same dialogue ulta if I do 246. Can an Indian company have a foreign holding company? Holding company in relation to one more company means a company. Here also company they have used. That's why they have inserted an explanation. Expression company includes body corporate. Which means what? A foreign company can have an Indian subsidiary. Indian company can have foreign subsidiary. Everything is covered under Companies Act. It will not be covered if you don't have anything here. If you are here, you are covered. That's the importance of these lines. Last part from that time I am telling, but this is really the last part. Government company. Government, last part. Government company. Now tell me. Government company is a company in which central government, state government has dash options. More than 50. More than or equal to 50. More than 51. More than or equal to 51. It says not less than 51% of TVP, subscribed share capital, issued share capital, paid up share capital, equity share capital, total share capital, all options. What do you want? Yes, here it is PUC, paid up share capital. More than or equal to 51% of paid up share capital. Two subsection 45, May 16 or something, they asked this question randomly. See, government company means a company in which not less than 51% of the paid up share capital is held by the central government or by any state government, partly by central, partly by one or more state, and includes a company, this is also includes a company which is a subsidiary company of such a government company. Means if the central government or state government holds, let's say 60% of PUC of X Limited, and X Limited is holding 70% of Y Limited, this is definitely a government company. This is also a government company because it says it includes subsidiary of such a government company. Subsidiary of such a government company. On the other hand, central government or state government has given to X Limited a loan of 100 crore. It's given a loan of 100 crore. And they have told, I will appoint 6 out of 10 directors in your board. Fair enough. They have got some money from the government. Government says, I'll have 6 out of 10 directors. And this X Limited also has 70% in this Y Limited. First question, is Y Limited subsidiary of X Limited? Yes, this one. Y Limited subsidiary of X Limited? Yes. Is X Limited a government company? Is X Limited a government company? No, why? Where does it say control composition here? Nothing. For a government company, it is only share capital based. Correct, no? Will you say X Limited is a subsidiary of government? Can you be a subsidiary of a government? No. So, subsidiary definition is different. Government company definition is different. Here, government is controlling 6 out of 10 directors. That does not make X Limited government company. Now, in auditors, if they ask this question, this is the last point, I swear. In the auditors, if they ask this question, here, X Limited, who will appoint the auditor of X Limited in the first scene? Government company, who will appoint? It's Comptroller and Auditor General. This Y Limited also is a deemed government company as per the definition. So, who will appoint CNDG? Now, tell me here. Shareholders or CNDG? Is X Limited a government company? No.
You all remember that for government company, who should appoint? C and A G, Comptroller and Auditor, Auditor appointment, Comptroller and Auditor General. So here who should appoint? Is X Limited a government company? No. Who should appoint? Board or shareholders? Shareholders, assume shareholders. Here also we'll assume shareholders. So under this section, like 139.7 and all that, that's a section of this this thing. 139. Right? So if you see 139.7, generally they speak about all these things. The first auditor shall be appointed by the Comptroller and Auditor General, but you will not read the first one. In case of a government company or any other company owned or controlled directly or indirectly by the center, this part actually is inserted in 2013 fresh. Owned or controlled directly or indirectly by the central government. Till today we thought only government company, but what all is covered? Government controlled company also. This X Limited is a government company? No. Is it a government controlled company? Yes. Because if I see the definition of control in 2 subsection 27, always I need to try and see if definition is given. Control shall include the right to appoint majority of directors. Got it? Control shall include the right to appoint majority of directors. Got it? So here also MCQ, one small question I'll give. Central government appointed 6 out of 10 directors in X Limited. What is X Limited now? Government controlled company. Who will appoint auditors? C and AG will appoint the auditors. MCQ will be tricky. This time apparently they are going to do case study based. It is easy. Once you read the Bayer Act, everything becomes easy. Case study based, they'll give one case study, they'll give you MCQ. Same. Instead of that, they were giving them 30 MCQs. In MCQ, not 30 exactly, 10 into 1, 10 into 2. 10 into 1, 1 mark, 10 questions till now. 10 into 2 marks. Does it mean 2 options are there? No. One option only, we should use some brains analysis. That's it. So this completes the basics. This foundation we have laid now. Isn't easy? Easy only. Very easy. Only understanding the Bayer Act. Now we will have to dive into cluster number 1 after the break. Right? So tell me guys, for 35-40 minutes enough? Yeah, so it's like 12:25 or something. 2:45 maybe we'll. 2:45. Alright, thank you guys. Let's meet 2:45 sharp. And continue. We'll start off with cluster number 1.